Our next speaker works at RIPE on the Atlas project, which tests the internet connection worldwide. And but in his hobby, as a hobby, he has a hobby OS which is based on Minix, which many of you should know. And but for his hobby OS, he needed a better file system, and he wanted to have a secure file system. And so this talk is about a secure file system for Minix, but probably also for Linux, but we'll get to know that. He would like to have a discussion and feedback afterwards. So please, if you see anything in his design where you think, this sucks, write it down and use the microphones later to discuss it with phicoh. Okay, please give a warm welcome to phicoh.
Hi, I'm phicoh, and before I start, I want to say this presentation is designed also to be accessible for non-crypto experts. So afterwards, give me feedback if you think, well, I got something out of it, or I completely failed to understand anything, let me know. For the crypto experts, so what I want to know is, well, can you immediately find some holes in it? Also, there's the issue like, if you think there should be crypto features here that I missed, also please let me know. And to spice it up a bit for crypto experts, in the last part of the talk, I will give a security analysis that is completely flawed. And then in the last slide, I will tell you what I did wrong. But if you know, well, you can also run to the microphone and say, okay, this is what you did wrong before I get to it. So, a bit of background. I have my own hobby OS, and not invented here is an explicit goal there. So I want to design software, I want to implement software, I want to learn how stuff works, because then later in work or in other situations, you are way more aware of all the design choices, etc., than if you just install some open source package, compile it, and make it run. So at some point, I also got to the point that I wanted to have a secure file system, and the obvious way to do it is to have an encrypted block device. So I started designing the crypto for such a block device, and then it didn't fit. Whatever I tried, I never got the security right. I knew sort of what kind of guarantees I wanted to have, and I couldn't make it work. So then in the end, I gave up and I said, well, I have to look at what other systems are doing, because obviously they have encrypted block devices in use. I mean, on Windows, you have TrueCrypt, and Linux have Lux, and then FreeBSD has Kali, etc. And then I found that basically none of them actually met my requirements. So at some point, I said, well, I have to take a step back and not try to have it in a separate layer in a block device, but maybe it should be an integral part of the file system itself. Then you can do a lot more stuff. And then I started designing what I will now present. There's another thing that I really don't like about file systems, how it's done today. I mean, I work a lot in networks. And what happens there is if you have a Linux host and a Windows host and a Mac, they can all talk to each other. Because people first set out and try to design some protocols, have standards for that, and then everybody tries to implement the same standard. And it's not always perfect, but by and large, it works. Whereas for a file system, it is everybody sits down and writes a file system for their operating system. So you have a completely unique file system. By and large, it doesn't have any specifications. There's just a bit of code. And if you're lucky, there's a white paper. And if anybody from another operating system wants to do it, then either they have to run exactly the same code or they have to painfully reverse engineer that file system. So I want to change how we approach designing file systems by actually first writing a design, then making sure that you can have a couple of independent implementations that can interoperate, and only then consider it a new file system. But that's sort of You cannot do that with an existing file system because there are already way too many file systems. So you can't say, okay, you're doing it all wrong, you need to follow my way. But there's almost no file systems that have built-in encryption. So I want to see if I can start a project that actually designs it like that instead of first focusing on a bit of code. And of course, also if you want to do crypto, then you need to have a good design that everybody can read and not just some code that does stuff. But that's not the topic of this talk. This is just a general thing. So then thinking about what I wanted to achieve, then the obvious thing is I want it to be secure. And secure here I define as it needs to provide secrecy. That's the obvious thing that you all want from an encrypted file system. But I also want to have integrity. If you leave a USB stick somewhere and somebody returns it to you, then it would be bad if somebody could hack that USB stick and then still take over your computer, even though you thought it had a secure file system on it. Then another principle, which is a bit tricky to define, so I'll focus on sort of the opposite. So the opposite of robustness is that it's fragile, and a good example of that is things like OpenSSL. So there you start with a TLS specification, which is completely horrible in its own way, and nobody understands how it works. And then on top of that, they also manage to make it worse to make sure that, well, it's as bad as possible. So I don't want that. I want to have a few simple components, and there's an explicit goal, reduce the number of components, make sure that all the interactions are simple and that a component can work, or, well, if you do it really wrong, it can fail. But there shouldn't be that in-between zone, like, well, if you flip this bit there, then it also becomes insecure. And then the third principle is simple, and that works in two ways. One is if you look again at something like OpenSSL, if that's just released, then no security researcher is ever going to bother to look at it. I mean, the first time you start reading a bit of code of that, you give up in disgust. So what you do is you wait until it got insanely popular, then you look at it, find an interesting bug, and then you make headlines. But that's not really the way to design secure systems. So I want to make sure that it's simple enough that I can explain it to security experts and that they can then say, oh, this is really stupid, you have to fix it. And maybe if people don't say that for a while, then you can say, oh, maybe it's sort of secure. Simple has another component, and that is most people who are not into crypto tend to treat security software or devices as a black box. So you add your magical security source, and then it will all be perfectly secure. And that almost never works, because security devices are designed to work in a context, and unless you perfectly understand what that context is, you probably deploy it the wrong way, and then it's still insecure. Which means that you have to know a bit, like, what is this really doing? You don't have to know all the details, but you have to have some vague awareness of what it does. So that's also why I try to have a simple design, because then you have more chance that people who are going to use it actually understand a bit what it's really doing and can evaluate whether it makes sense. And then sort of to avoid starting out creating the next ButterFS or something like that, I want to have a really simple file system. So it should be modern, it should have all, normal stuff like inodes and attributes and stuff like that, but it shouldn't immediately have every different kind of checkpointing, cloning, etc. thrown in that you can think of. So that's why I think of it as a secure FAT32 replacement. Another thing that a lot of projects are not doing is they say, well, we do encryption, and then they give a general overview of what kind of encryption they do, and then they start listing all the different block ciphers and other stuff that you can use, but they are never explicit on what the attack model is. And the problem there is that if you think there's something wrong, then you never know whether you got outside the attack model or that it actually bug. And also, sometimes people report bugs, and then people immediately say, yeah, but that's not part of the attack model. That works also the other way around, is that if you want to use it, then basically you have to study the whole design of that system to sort of reconstruct what the attack model could be to see whether it actually fits your use case. And there's only a few people that could do it. So then stuff gets deployed in a context where it probably doesn't work. So I want to be explicit about the attack model, and I try to come up with these three classes of attack that I want to protect against. So the first one, the single version read-only, is essentially where if you lose a USB stick. So the attacker gets to see your entire file system, but it's only one instance in time. And from a crypto point of view, that makes a lot of difference, because there's a lot of attacks that you can only do if you see multiple versions. So this is basically the easiest thing to do. And also, most current block encryption systems actually work quite well in this, because, for example, if you only lose your USB stick, then integrity doesn't become an issue, because there's no way in the attack model that the attacker will try to modify any bits. Then the next one, for a couple of years at my work, on my desk there was a backup disk, and then, well, when I was at work, my work laptop would just make a backup to the backup disk, but the disk just stayed there on my desk. Which means that in theory, every night, either security or cleaners or something like that, could make a copy of the backup disk and then start analyzing all the differences. And unless you specifically design for that, it's easy to come up with crypto that is perfectly secure if you see only one version, but then if you see the complete evolution of the file system, then it leaks way too much and you may even be able to decrypt it. So that's a separate step. And then, of course, there's the last one, and there you can, for example, think of online storage. Suppose that you have an ice cozy thing, or maybe in the future clouds will offer some sort of block storage. There, an attacker can also try to modify bits, so there you have to be really make sure that if an attacker tries to do that you will attack that and not allow that to happen. And there's two things that I'm specifically not doing. If you have a running computer with key material in the computer, there's all kinds of ways that key material can leak. So I'm not looking into that. I'm only looking at what kind of encrypted bits get written out to a disk, and can you attack only based on looking at those bits and not looking at the stuff inside the computers that does the encryption. And there's another part that sometimes comes up and that I don't look into is a plausible deniability. If you're interested in that, you can always talk to me afterwards to see whether or not that should be included or not. So to give a bit of a crypto background for people who don't know it, these are the crypto primitives that I am going to use. The first one, SHA-256, a hash function. You give the arbitrary input, it comes out with 256 bits, and it has some unique properties that if you have such a sequence of bits, you can never find any input that would result in the same bits, well, unless you created that yourself. If you know what goes in, then of course you can know. But otherwise, it's not reversible. So this is very good for integrity checks. Then, in some cases, I need a construct where you do the same kind of hashing, but then with a key, and that's the HMAC SHA-256. So you can see that as a signature scheme, but it's not a traditional public key signature scheme where one party signs and the other one and everybody can verify. Here basically everybody who wants to sign and verify has to have the same key, but anybody who doesn't have the key cannot do anything. Well, AES is essentially the standard block cipher. There's basically no need to think about other block ciphers. And I like block ciphers because of the additional robustness you get from a block cipher. And in this case, I use CBC because a block cipher can only encrypt the basic block of the block cipher, which is 128 bits for AES. And of course, we need to encrypt an entire disk block, which is a lot longer. So then you need to have a way to chain those blocks, and CBC is one of the methods there. And then finally, there's a crypto primitive called Argon2, and that's basically that if you give a system a password, then all of the crypto that we have is designed to be as fast as possible, which means that if somebody wants to do a brute force on your password, then you're in a really bad situation, because that attacker can buy some dedicated hardware and try a gazillion passwords per second and break your password. So what password hashing functions like Argon2 try to do is to be slow. They try to guarantee that they're slow. You give them some parameters to define how slow they should be, and then basically they try to make the life of the attacker that wants to speed it up as hard as possible. You shouldn't be able to speed it up unless you spend a lot of money, and that way you can prevent people from doing passwords guessing attacks. So these are the primitives that I need. And then this is sort of the core, the really simple construct that I came up with. And basically, if you look at the file system in a really abstract sense, then it's a tree-like data structure. So you have stuff that points to other stuff. In the typical file system, you have inodes, and they point to data blocks. If you load large file, then they point to indirect blocks. But you can also have B-trees and other stuff. It's all stuff pointing to other stuff. And typically, if you do that, then you include a block number. And I also have a block number here. And basically, that says, well, this points to stuff, or this block somewhere on disk. Then, borrowing from ZFS, if you want to do integrity checks, then together with this block pointer, you need to have some information about the contents. That way, if you try to access it, then you know where it is, but you also know what to expect. ZFS assumed hardware errors, so they typically have a CRC, but I assume an attacker, so I have a full SHA-256 hash value there. Then, moving on, there's another thing that you need for encryption, and that's a bit of randomness. And historically, in crypto literature, that is called an initialization factor. So I just keep calling it an initialization factor, though in fact it's just a bunch of random bits. There's no magic. And then I still have 64 bits left because I want to pad it to a nice power of 2. And then I use one flag to specify whether it's big endian or little endian, but that's irrelevant for this talk. So that's the basic concept. Then using this, I can define how you would, I've them in the wrong order. Okay, so what you now can do is you can create arbitrary linked data structures, but you run into one problem, is that if you have a block and you say, well, this is the root of my tree, then you need to have a pointer again that points to the root of your tree. So you get sort of an infinite recursion, well, not turtles all the way down, but pointers all the way up. That will never stop, so you need to do something special to break that recursion. So the other thing that you get if you use these kinds of pointers is that if you have a traditional file system, then if you overwrite a block, then you try to write to the same place. That's in normal file systems most efficient operation, because then you don't have to change any of the metadata. You just write, update a block, and you're done. But if you have those pointers that include information about the contents, that means that as you write a block, you always also have to update a pointer to the block. And that leads to a system that is called copy on write. So instead of, if you update a block, you write it to the original location, you will always write it to an empty space on disk. And that has the convenience that if something goes wrong, then you can easily roll back, because you never damage anything in your file system, because you always write to empty space. And if you then continue with that, then the logical way to deal with that is you have checkpoints. So as soon as you think, okay, I made a bunch of modifications, then you write down a new checkpoint block that essentially make those modifications official, and then you can make new modifications. So the name of checkpoint is coming from this concept. But then security-wise, what a checkpoint block tries to do is it tries to have a pointer and block data in the same location. So what you can see here, this first part is essentially the same as a block pointer. And then it's followed by the data. But the way it's written out is different, because instead of having just a hash function, now it needs to be a signed hash function, because it's no longer encrypted and checked at a higher level. And then the other thing is there's a split, because the other three fields, the random, the initialization factor, and the flags, and the block number, they are actually encrypted, and only the signed hash is not encrypted. If you do that, then for checkpoints, again, it makes sense from a file system layout point of view to have them somewhere in the middle of the disk. But if they're in the middle of the disk, you never know how to find them. So you need to have something at the start of the disk that will actually tell them you where they are. So that's traditionally called a super block. And the other thing you need to do is you need to do something with the password. So that's here. I said that Argon2 has parameters that you can specify how slow it is. We can assume that hardware continues to evolve, so you need to be able to specify those parameters in your file system, otherwise you would be stuck. So that's the first two fields. And then the remainder looks very much like the construct I had for the checkpoint. You get a block pointer, but it's split in that weird way that you have a signed hash and then the rest encrypted. And there's another thing, and that is here. Instead of using the password directly to encrypt the disk, I store a disk encryption key explicitly in the super block, because that has the advantage that if I want to change my password, then I only have to write out new super blocks, and I can still keep the same disk encryption key. Or even another way would be to have multiple passwords, multiple super blocks that would all include the same disk key, because then you could access the file system using multiple passwords. And basically, from a data structure point of view, that's it. There's no more. That's all the different primitives, file system primitives, that you need to create a full file system. So next thing I'll try to describe for the three types of blocks, how encryption and decryption sort of works. So this is, if you just have an ordinary block, you start creating a block pointer where you take here the plain text, hash it, and you have a hash, initialization factor is a random number, the flags get filled in, and of course you have to know where to write it in disk, so that's the position. Then I generate a key to encrypt it with using this HMAC construction. So this disk key, that's the secret key for the entire disk. And then using this block pointer, I can create a new encryption key, and then I use the AES CBC with that key. I need the initialization factor and the plain text to generate ciphertext. Decrypting is almost the other way around. You assume that you have a block pointer that has the block number, so you can read the ciphertext. Using this block pointer, we can again compute that encryption key. We can do the AES decrypt that gives a plain text. Then, of course, we have to hash the plain text such that we verify that the hash of the plain text is indeed the same as the hash that was stored in the block pointer to make sure that the integrity check works out. So that's essentially 99% of all the disk I/O operations, because this is all the normal blocks that they will all go through this process. Then occasionally you make a checkpoint. So you again have the random data, flags, you know where to write a checkpoint, and you have the checkpoint data. So that's together the plain text. You hash it, but in this case, because an attacker might tamper with it, you need to use an HMAC construction to protect it. So that gets put here. Then, because we don't have on decode, decrypt the entire block pointer, we have only the signed hash, we can only use the signed hash as input for the encryption key. So that's here. And then we just encrypt it with that key. We also don't have an initialization factor, so that can be set to zero, and then encrypt it. And then the decrypt is again almost upside down. You create a decrypt key from the block, from the signed hash, decrypt it, then you have this. Then you have to, again, of course, compute this HMAC SHA2 to compare and make sure that nobody tried to tamper with the checkpoint block. This happens essentially every time you do a sync, etc., to make a new checkpoint. And then you have the super block, and that gets modified essentially only when you create a file system, so that always almost never happens. So here I have these argon2 parameters, and everything I write to disk is encrypted, so it all looks like random data. And then to me it felt really wrong to just write a few integers as the parameters, just as something that stands out, like, well, this is this type of encrypted file system. So I decided to mask it a bit, but of course this is not real security. So I fear an encryption key, and then I crypt the parameters with that key, and that basically only scrambles it to make sure that it all completely looks like random data, even though if an attacker knows that it's there, then the attacker can still immediately decrypt it. So then argon2 takes quite a few parameters, like the number of iterations, amount of memory, there's something about parallelism, how long the key should be, and assault. And then the user's password. So that is what I call the super key. And then basically you encrypt with the super key, but that's the same as in the checkpoint block. You compute the hash function using HMAC SHA2, using a signing key, and then use CBC encrypted. And then, of course, each time you boot the system, you first have to decrypt the super block. But like all the other constructions, that's almost the same thing, upside down. So you have to extract these parameters by decrypting it with that salt. You take the password, then you construct the super key. And then basically you can create the decryption key, and you can create a hash, compare it, and you're done. So these are essentially just six operations that you would need to implement, and that's it. Then, to look a bit on whether this is actually secure, I now look at the three different types of blocks, and I have three different types of attacks. So basically, the next will be nine different versions of a block type combined with an attack type. So if we start with the data block and you have a single version read-only, then it's safe if you analyze for an attack. It's best to assume that you that the attacker already knows quite a bit of plain text. So that's called a non-plain text attack, because usually file systems contain all kinds of stuff that an attacker can just predict. If you assume that, then you assume that an attacker can try to brute force the AES encryption key, though in practice this is obviously not possible. But then the attacker could reconstruct the block pointer and then again brute force the HMAC to find the sys key. And all of that is basically impossible. So if we look at the decrypt block procedure, then an attacker, would have to start here with a known plain text attack, try to recover the key, and then again do a brute force to recover the disk key. But that's, if we assume that those underlying crypto primitives are secure, then that's completely impossible. If we now look at the multiple versions, then what you may have noticed is that every time you change something to a block, you get a different encryption key. So you get a different encryption key if the contents of the blocks is different, because you have a different hash. If the blocks are written in different locations, but they're the same contents, you get a different key because the location is different. And even if it's the same block, at the same location, because the initialization vectors are random numbers, you still get a different encryption key. So that means that from an attacker's point of view, you cannot tell anything. You can only see that there's new random data written, but you cannot correlate it in any way. But this is, I have to warn that this is only the encryption part. So if you have the actual file system layout, then from disk write patterns, an attacker still might get information about what you're doing from the way blocks are written, but the encryption itself doesn't leak anything. So you can see that clearly over here. It's the hash function gets its input, the random number, the block number. So it's every time it will be different, and the attacker will see a completely new set of random bits. Then that's where the attacker tries to modify it. So one attack here is an attacker could try to come up with encrypted plain text data that results in exactly the same hash as is stored in the block pointer. And then obviously we wouldn't detect that. As long as SHA-256 is considered secure, that's of course not possible. The other attack possibility is that the attacker can try to change the block pointer itself. But that requires modifying another block in an undetected way. And if you go up and up and up the tree, then essentially that requires changing a checkpoint. So if we assume that checkpoints are also secure, then from that we can assume that all the data blocks cannot be modified. So these are the attacks on a normal data block. So that's showing here, and it basically it's this compare. So an attacker has two choices. Either you make sure that this hash stays the same, that is the second pre-image attack, or you can try to update the block pointer somewhere. Moving on to the checkpoint. We again assume a known plaintext attack. So there, the attacker can try the same as the data block. You brute force AES and then you brute force an HMAC, which probably not possible. And then there's also an option that is you try to brute force the HMAC and the AES at the same time, which is again not possible, but it's slightly different. And but you have to here be worried that if the disk key would be weak, then you could brute force that key directly. Whereas even if the disk key is weak, then doing these two separate steps are completely impossible. So it's best to sort of concentrate on this attack, because that would be the most practical attack for an attacker. And that shows here. You can either go for brute forcing this, and then brute forcing this one in two separate steps, or you can just have a guess what could the disk key be, and then do this step, and then do check whether or not that matches your expected known plaintext. Then multiple versions. Basically, there's no assumption to assume that they will ever be the same. So then you get a different encryption key every time that would happen. And the other thing is that because checkpoints are in known locations for an attacker, it's probably very easy to figure out from the disk access pattern what checkpoint blocks are. So the fact that they are written will be known, but the contents is not. That's not really interesting. Furthermore, then you can try to modify a checkpoint. Of course, that the whole integrity of a file system depends on that. There again, you can try to do the second pre-image attack. And you can attack a signed hash. But for that, you again need to brute force the disk. You need to brute force the disk signing key. But in that case, if you would be able to do that, you could just as well brute force the disk key itself. So basically, it's an attack that would be essentially the same as breaking the encryption. So we can assume that will not happen. So that's here. So if you want to have the same contents, then you would have to come up with new plain text such that this compare would work, or otherwise you would want to brute force the disk key to make sure that you can actually generate new signed hashes and write them to disk. Then superblock. The superblock is of course the most interesting one because that's protected by password. And there, the thing is that you cannot say anything about the quality of the password from an engineering point of view. You can only tell users should have a good password. So it's safe to assume that the best way to attack the system is to just do password guessing, because all the other attacks are essentially impossible. And that's exactly where we should be. I mean, the weakest point of an encrypted file system should be the password and not any other components. So then basically, you would try to brute force here the Archon 2 thing. And of course, Archon 2 is specifically designed to prevent that, but you have to keep the parameters right. And that there could be issues that if you have a file system on an extremely slow device, then you have to choose relatively weak Archon 2 parameters, or you have to wait a long time. And then an attacker with state-of-the-art equipment has an advantage. But that's all stuff that is basically unavoidable, and you have to tell users, well, generate a good password on a fast enough system and use that. Then, well, many versions of a superblock, that basically doesn't happen because we don't expect the superblock to change. You maybe change it to change the password or resize a file system, but that's something so obvious to an attacker, it's not really interesting. And if the attacker wants to modify the superblock, then that's the same as modifying a checkpoint. And again, sort of breaking the entire encryption is the best way to attack that. So there's no way to just violate integrity without just completely breaking the system. So that's the basic secure analysis, assuming that everything gets implemented properly. But then from experience, we know that systems tend to end up with broken random number generators. And there's a few famous ones in comics. You can choose 9 if you like Dilbert, or 4 for XKCD. But Debian at some point managed to completely screw up. But also, if you have an embedded system, then even if you try to do the right thing, then it's still possible that you may not have enough entropy, because those devices sometimes have not a lot of input. So where do your random numbers come from? Not all of them have hardware random number generators, etc. So I want to do an analysis based on what happens if the random number is broken. And so this is the part where if you can spot a design flaw, then just go to the microphone and say, well, what you presented so far is insecure under the assumption that the random number generator is flawed. So if we do the analysis, then basically if you have a single version, then you don't need the randomness. So you need the randomness for a data block that if you have multiple versions, then you want to make sure that you have a different encryption key every time. But if you just have a single version of the file system, then all of that doesn't matter. So basically you don't need any randomness for that. That's because all of the block contents is already input to the key. So if the attacker already knows the complete contents of the block, well, then it doesn't really matter whether the attacker can still know something. If you have multiple versions, then if the random number generator is broken to the extent that it's predictable, and that's one of the common attacks on the random number generators, then all the blocks will have different encryption keys, so the system is still secure. So then only if the random number generator is broken to the point that it will always return exactly the same number, then you need to have blocks with identical content, and they need to be on the same position on disk, and then they would actually end up with exactly the same encryption key. And then an attacker can see that you are writing an identical block to an identical position. So it's some information that gets leaked, but it's sort of the most horrible situation when it comes to your random number generator, and it's just a small amount of leakage, because it's not that often that you write the same contents to exactly the same place in disk. That's showing here that if the block number is different, then you get a different key. If the hash is different, so only if that's all the same and the initialization factor is the same, then you would actually reuse a key. And then, of course, if an attacker tries to do an attack, an integrity attack, that's not affected by randomness. If you look at a checkpoint, then the single version doesn't matter, because it's only one version, that key will be unique. If you have multiple versions, then we expect all checkpoints to be different. I mean, that's why it's a checkpoint, that something has changed on the file system, and then you write out of a checkpoint. So it would be really weird if you have an identical checkpoint. In theory, it can happen, and then, of course, if indeed the random number generator would be constant, then you would leak the fact that you would have an identical checkpoint, but that's an extremely remote situation. And, of course, again, if you try to modify it, that does not depend on randomness. So going for the superblock, you do not need any randomness. Well, it will make maybe make the salt and the argon 2 parameters stand out a bit. Basically, you don't write the super block. So you only would write a new version if something changed, which results in a new key. So there again, you don't need any randomness. Going too fast. Of course, you only don't modify it. So now it's like, well, this looks like it's secure, and now I sort of cleverly, well, it took me a while to realize that what was wrong, and that I skipped one part. And the part that I skipped, and that basically completely breaks what I said so far, is that part of the superblock is the actual disk encryption key. And I already hinted to that if you could brute force the disk encryption key, because it's somehow predictable, then of course it will completely break. So if we assume that you have a bad random number generator, then basically you have to assume that disk encryption key that is generated is also bad. And when I realized that, if I take the random number that I generate for the disk encryption key and then hash it with the superblock key, which is derived from the password, then if it's a strong random number, then it will not change anything, because it will just be different bits, but the same quality of bits. But if the random data is really bad, then it will at least be as strong as your disk password. And given that already the best way to attack the disk is to attack the password, so that basically you get the same security. So that's the end of my talk. If you have any questions, like to comment, etc., let me know.
Yeah. So, thank you. So, thank you, Filco. I see a lot of questions lined up. We have 10 minutes for Q&A, so go ahead.
Hi. I had a simple question, because you started off with saying that you wanted to have a nice design document that other people could implement, but I only saw just now on the website you only published the slides, and I didn't see any links for a design document on the slides. So, do you plan to publish this as well, or?
Yes. So in sort of typical following tradition, I started writing code. But it's sort of on purpose that I don't have a design document because I want to have feedback on the crypto part. I don't want to spend a lot of time writing it down and then see people say, okay, this is really stupid. So after SHA, I will sit down and start working on actually nailing it down.
Okay, because I had some questions on the, I couldn't really follow all your steps, and I saw that you sometimes use an IV with non-random, which is basically electronic codebook, etc. So I had some questions also why you use Argon and not a key derivation function, etc. So, but I will then look a bit more in detail in the slides again, and I will send you some an email with some commands then.
Yeah, and you can always send me an email, then I could try to keep track of your email address, that when I have written that down, then I can send you a link and then...
Okay, perfect. Yeah.
Please talk into the microphone.
Yep. I'll lower it a bit. Just a simple question. Why are you using straight hashes for the data blocks and no HMAX there? Because then the contents of the hashes will give an indication of the contents, so that leaks information.
So the assumption is that for normal block pointers, they will always be stored encrypted. Mm-hmm. So given that there's no way that an attacker can get directly access to them, it seems pointless to protect, have extra protection. So they will, of course, be visible inside a file system cache. But in that case, you probably already have all the necessary key material to load the block and just decrypt it and look at what really the contents is. It's not clear to me what kind of attack you can come up with where having an HMAC would actually make a difference.
I can come up with one. So you do carving over the disk, and you're looking for a specific file of which you know the hash already. Or of which you know the contents, and then you can recreate the hash and compare it to what's on disk.
But how would you... as an attacker, how would you get access to those hash values? Because you cannot...
Well, you're trying to verify that a certain file is on the disk. That's my attack model.
But... So if you have a file system that does deduplication, mm-hmm. then that would work very well. Which is basically don't have a file system that does deduplication. But that's a file system function. So mm-hmm. so if you see this as, well, say, a simple FAT32 file system, then the only thing you can do is write a new file to the file system, which doesn't tell you about any of the other files that are there. Or you can try to read the file, and if there's protection, then you wouldn't be able to read it. So it's not clear how...
For example, if I get hold of a device which is encrypted with this file system,
yeah,
and I know it's a certain architecture, and for that architecture, there's a library which is vulnerable, and I want to know if that version of the library is on the file system.
Yeah, but all of those those hash values are also encrypted. So you can never directly read a hash value from the disk, because that will be in an encrypted block.
Not sure, but we can discuss afterwards.
Try that all. Yeah,
yep.
Please do.
I was wondering, with respect to the use of the cipher block chaining in combination with the possibility of hardware errors in file allocation table blocks. Because if you do the cipher block chaining, well, you have something, probably an 8K block. While if you would use some counter mode for those blocks, you would maybe have some more recovery possibilities in case of partial failure.
You're right. Nowhere in my design I have included the possibility of recovering from errors. That's not there. I think that for CBC, if you have one block wrong, then I think you should be able to recover most of it. But I'm not sure. I mean, the problem I have with counter mode is that if you, for whatever reason, and end up with the same key twice, then you completely leak all the data that is encrypted with that key. So I try to avoid those kind of stream-like ciphers as much as possible. But you have a good point that maybe if you want to recover data, that it would be more robust.
Especially, I think, for the file allocation table blocks, maybe it would be a good way to say file allocation blocks have a duplicate, or either use only counter mode for those and CBC for the rest?
Well, things like having storing multiple copies, that would be more up to the file system layout part, because of course you can store multiple copies of blocks if you think it's really important. That would not change the encryption. So it's only if you assume you have one block and you assume that there's bit errors and also assume that you don't have proper backups, then yes, you might be right.
We have three more speakers, so please keep it short. Three more questions.
Suppose if I would be an attacker and I would have access to the disk several times, and first I make a copy of the disk, and then the next time I see what's changed, and I know where the checkpoint blocks are, and I replace the blocks that that I know I probably won't like, and the matching checkpoint block with the old version, how would you think?
So there's one thing. That this completely cannot defend against, and that is, yes, if you roll back the entire contents of the file system, then there's no way you can detect that you're dealing with an old version of the file system. But you have to roll it back to the entire old version, because otherwise, at some point, you will notice that something is wrong.
So are there multiple checkpoint blocks?
Yeah, there are multiple, but one should be active at any one time.
Okay.
But yeah, if you save a copy of the file system and then at a later time restore that copy on the disk, then to the user of the file system it looks like, this is a valid file system, because it was a valid file system in the past. And in this design, there's nothing I can do about it.
Please do the discussion afterwards.
Sorry.
Hi, could I see the last slide, please, again, the cheating one?
Yep.
So if I change my password, now I also change my disk key, which is in paradigm.
No, you cannot do that. So if your first password was weak, and the random number was also really weak, then you're stuck with that. But if you change the password, then you would keep the same disk key. It only protects essentially when the disk key is generated and not afterwards.
Okay, I see. Okay, thanks.
No.
Next.
Hey, just a small question.
You can lower the mic, this might be easier.
Probably easier, yeah. Thanks. A few slides back, you were talking about a hash of the plain text. Am I correct? This is the hash of the plain text, the SHA-256 hash?
That's normally hash. Which do you
even more back? More.
Was it a checkpoint or a data block?
I think it was some kind of the CRC replacement hash.
Oh, that. I can go to any data block. So here. Let's see. Let's see. I can.
The block itself said SHA-256 hash.
But there should be that one, you may, here on the right.
I'm not seeing the hash here either.
I think that.
Let's use this one. So this one, the SHA-256 hash of the plain text, is stored directly in front of the block.
No. If it's stored in front of the block, then you would be talking about a checkpoint block. And in that case, what is stored here is a signed hash, so that's an HMAC.
No, I'm not talking about that one.
Oh.
There was a hash. I'm pretty sure it was about the hash of the plain text. And the thing was that that hash was never solved in any way.
Okay, we should take this offline, I guess.
Sorry, we have 1 minute left. Thank you. Can I have an applause again for... Okay.